My name is Jonathan Meades, and this series is called Further Abroad. It's set in a distant present, in a land where there's no such word as ordinary, and where every...
Steady, friends. Steady, boy.
I must make my position clear. I believe the finest, fondest way to show affection for an animal is to eat it. This is, I admit, a conviction that has yet to find much favour with my compatriots. If it had found favour, we'd see a lot more Spaniel burgers and Labrador chops and New Season's puppy than we actually do. We don't see any. Not here in Blighty, we don't. We've been granting dog this special status as man's best friend, and what do we get in return? We get nothing. Pooch does not deliver. It's time that he took redundancy. It's time, too, that man found himself a new best friend.
Too haughty. And too fond of drugs. All take and no give. All bone and gristle, frankly.
Pigs! Pigs. That's more like it. Mate and meat, chum and chop. But where do you find them? Where do pigs live?
Pigs live in supermarkets. Posthumous pigs, that is. Pigs who suffered their fatal accident and are now graced with a new name, Pork. The buildings themselves, which are usually beside bypasses or on former industrial estates, are crudely packaged to suggest barns or farm buildings or stables, something generically rustic, which hints at the alleged source of the produce.
But the way Pork is packaged is designed to disguise the source of the meat, to make us forget that it was once animal. There occurs such a massive transformation between pig and pork that it's possible to envisage a future when the majority of pork's consumers will be ignorant of its origins as a quadruped. These shapes might form the jigsaw of absolutely anything. They're sops to our thin-skinned consciences. Both object and name assist forgetfulness. There, that should do it.
Old-style butchers did not go in for euphemism. A dead animal is a dead animal, and that's that. Its carcass sits alongside a tiled representation of how it was when it was alive. No doubt this candour fails to suit our predominantly suburban sensibilities. Maybe that's why so much public money has been devoted to closing these places.
Oh, that'll be ready then. Smells good. Magic. That's my boy. A pet that's fit for the pot. You can coo at him, you can chew at him.
The pig's reputation is in need of rehabilitation. Pig abuse is an entrenched tradition. But if any creature is forced to wallow in its own excrement, it'll be bound to be filthy. They're so often subjected to squalor, they're reckoned squalid. Pigs have a bad name. No wonder the 79.9% of policemen who are straight as the day is long object to being called pigs. Equally, 100% of pigs object to having their name attached to the rotten apples. We must distinguish between what's done to them and what they are. The only living creatures who humans routinely mistreat to the extent that they mistreat pigs are fellow humans. And here is the key to our pigism, to our negligent speciesism. We find it difficult to respect an animal that so surely reminds us of ourselves, omnivorous, accommodating, hairless, prone to sunburn, with a strong facial resemblance. The buildings that pigs live in are a measure of the esteem or contempt in which they are held by humans. This has been far from consistent. Pigs have lived in palaces. More usually, they haven't. More usually, we can see that pigs are reckoned to be close to the bottom of the pile. The message to pigs is clear. You're not worth bothering with. Once a pig is relegated to the position of product, to being nothing more than an economic unit, it is treated, mistreated, as though it was inanimate. Once it is a number on a production line, it has no more life than, say, a camshaft. In factory farms, pigs are prisoners looking not only at a death sentence, but at a grotesque travesty of life and non-life before they arrive at the day of execution, which must come as a relief. How did it all go so wrong for these amiable beasts? The enclosure of common land between 1760 and 1860 didn't help. This mass theft in the name of agrarian progress killed off small holdings. And it deprived the pig, the domestic familiar of the rural peasantry, of the terrain where it had rooted down the centuries. One of the few areas of England where small holdings are still the norm is the New Forest. Here, commoners may exercise rights of panage and mast. That is, they may allow their pigs to wander and to feed off acorns and beechnuts on common land. This is pig paradise, and it's pretty heavenly for humans too. The contemporary squeamishness about eating animals, which have been our familiars, derives partly from our no longer inhabiting houses, which might also accommodate pigs.
Come on, Rosie.
Our animal familiars now are nothing more than pets. In the past, the roles of the pig were not mutually exclusive. Every cottage had a sty. The English today have a problem with the sources of meat because they are mostly dislocated from them. These commons round the perambulations of the New Forest are among the few remaining places in Britain where the ramshackle beauty of the working country is diminished by neither tourist board prettification nor agribiz uglification. And at the centre is the pig.
Of course, pigs don't have to have access to common land in order to lead dignified and fulfilling lives before they're eaten. This one lives in chaotic, if picturesque, circumstances in what used to be the solitary confinement block of a German POW camp. Once a sty. Inventive improvisation is to be found wherever small-scale pig farming is practiced. On allotments, say, or, in this case, in former cottages.
The pigs that enjoy the privileges of such accommodation are not members of commercial herds. They're hobby pigs, show pigs, indulged pigs. Now, corrugated iron and breeze block may seem odd materials with which to indulge a prized animal, but they don't have to be base. They can be used resourcefully, to the loved one's advantage.
I've had very good success at Charn. The first pig I shoe was a boar down at Gloucester, NPBA Charn Sale. And I've also gone on from there to the South Suffolk, the Royal Norfolk, Royal Show, the Great Yorkshire and the East of England, with many prize winners from all the shows. I've also had two winners in the Pig of the Year round. My son Paul, he's helped me now with the pigs for Sean. He also now, or last year, he's taken the first pig on his own. He's also beaten me in the ring as well. As people which show pigs with me, other farmers and that, have said that he's going to be a hard man to beat in years to come.